Hey, it's great to be here. I am a co-founder at Determined AI and also an assistant professor in the machine learning department at CMU. And today I'll be talking to you guys today about some work on massively parallel hyperparameter optimization. Feel free to interrupt with questions or anything, you know, at any time. Right, so to start, I kind of want to just set the stage a little bit. You know, there's a lot of you guys here excited about deep learning. I was a grad student at NYU 10 years ago. Nobody could care less about what I was doing. It was machine learning, but the world has changed. You know, flying in from Pittsburgh today, you see billboards coming into New York. It's a different world that we're in. It seems like we're in the golden age of machine learning. If you think about it from a research perspective, right, the success we've seen in image recognition, starting with ImageNet and other amazing applications, has been kind of... So, yeah, the success we're seeing from ImageNet is really exciting. What's now called the NURBS, NURBS conference, which is kind of the premier machine learning conference. There's kind of this joke that was going online a little while ago, which is that if the growth in registrations continues over the next, I don't know, two or three decades, registrations in NIPS will outpace human population, right? It's just things are kind of exploding. From an industry perspective, some of the biggest companies in the world, you know, whether it's Amazon or Google, are really leaning into AI. It's really hard to hire people. Everyone's fighting. Salaries are kind of ridiculous. We're seeing really cool applications coming out of from these companies. Educationally, right, so CMU started an AI major this year. At Stanford and pretty much everywhere else, computer science is the biggest thing that's happening. It's the biggest major. Everybody wants to get into it. Thankfully, Keras for kindergartners is not real, but it sort of feels like things are starting that soon. Right, so the question, it seems like we're in this golden age, and there's a question, are we ready for widespread adoption? My argument is that the field of aviation is sort of a sobering example of where we actually are right now. So this is a picture of the Wright brothers, circa 1903. This is, you know, at Kitty Hawk, they kind of were the first to show that powered flight was a real thing. Right, but they really only flew for tens of seconds and hundreds of meters. This is really just, you know, this is this pioneer moment. Only they really believed, and a handful of other people believed that this was real. Fast forward just 7 years, you know, they had gained widespread acceptance of this idea. People agreed that powered flight was going to change the world. It was in the World's Fair. Kind of funnily, the Wright brothers themselves decided it was such a great idea that, you know, and they were entrepreneurs. They tried to start a commercial aviation business. It didn't work, it was really exciting around 1910, but aviation was really restricted. You know, it was in wars, and it was restricted to very rich people. It was not kind of commercially a thing that you could actually, you know, use. And it took, you know, almost half a century before the commercial jet age finally arrived. So it was a long time from 1903 until people could actually go to an airport and fly across the country or across the world. Right, so what led to this commercial jet age? Well, it was powered by advances in aeronautical engineering. So things like efficiency, we needed the turbine engine to be able to fly across the country or across the world in a reasonable amount of time. In terms of automation, we needed better ways to sort of build planes or even fly planes, right, in an automated fashion. In terms of safety, we needed new ways of testing these airplanes to make them safer. We needed new regulatory agencies, things like the FAA, to make sure that flying was actually commercially safe. So, the point of all of this, you know, we're talking about deep learning, what's the point? I would argue that we're kind of in the pioneer age of machine learning right now. Right? So the ImageNet, the success of ImageNet was sort of our Wright brothers' aha moment. This is a real thing. Deep learning, machine learning more broadly, really can have a huge impact on society. We're all sitting here today, all really excited about machine learning and deep learning. It's sort of culturally accepted, but it's really hard to actually use. And so the question is, what do we kind of need to do to get to this jet age, to make things easier and more accessible for a wider range of people? And I'd argue that, you know, solving issues related to efficiency, automation, and safety are kind of these same sort of issues or things that need to be addressed in the context of machine learning and deep learning. What I'm going to be talking today about are problems, you know, some problems in the context of efficiency and automation. And at the end, I'll kind of circle back to the broader set of problems that I think need to be solved for us to really, you know, get to the jet age of machine learning. Right, so I'll be talking about training and tuning models and ways to kind of hopefully improve that. And kind of to set the stage and motivate the problem, I'm going to show you some quotes from a paper by a former colleague of mine when he was working at Google Brain. This was a research paper focused on machine translation, and there were some really salient quotes in the paper. The first says, you know, a major drawback of current architectures is that they're expensive. It takes days to weeks of GPU time to train a single model. That's a lot of time and a lot of money. Even worse, for this particular paper, and this is a good example of just deep learning in general, this was not a Google scale task. This was an academic benchmark on a single English to German translation task. It took them 250,000 GPU hours to sort of do the training and hyperparameter optimization, the tuning, to get a result that they were able to publish. Right? That's a lot of time. That's almost $250,000 as well, given current cloud-based costs. And again, this was for one effectively toy example to publish a paper. Right, so what I'm going to be talking today are about new methods to speed up the time and the cost of this hyperparameter optimization problem. I'll first kind of introduce, make sure we're all on the same page about what hyperparameter optimization actually is, and then I'll talk about two related methods that sort of are our approach to build or to improve in this area. All right, so I imagine most of you might know about hyperparameter optimization, but just to set the stage, and even to start even a little bit bigger, this term AutoML gets thrown around a bunch these days. What is AutoML? It's sort of trying to automate all aspects of machine learning workflows from before you do any learning, so data cleaning, data featureization. It then includes things like autoscaling training, hyperparameter optimization, which is the focus of today's talk, but then also things afterwards related to deployment, and then kind of broader things related to visualization, interpretability, fairness, privacy, things like that. So it's kind of this broad umbrella of problems. Again, hyperparameter optimization is an important subcomponent of AutoML. It's focused on tuning knobs of machine learning models and algorithms. So whether that's the regularizer in ridge regression, or tree depth in a decision tree, or step size for an optimization algorithm like SGD. And why I'm talking about it here today is because hyperparameter optimization is a fundamental component of deep learning. There's a lot of knobs to tune. Optimization, things like dropout rate. You can tune the architecture itself, right? There's a lot of ways to design architectures. And therefore, tuning, how you tune these networks is crucial to their success. It's worth noting, it's not the focus of this talk, though I'll get back to it a little bit later, is that there is this kind of new subfield within hyperparameter optimization that's received a lot of excitement and hype in the last few years called neural architecture search. And it really is a subproblem of hyperparameter optimization, focused, though, on tuning the knobs that control the network architecture itself, right? And as I mentioned, this is a specialized subproblem of hyperparameter optimization. As I'll show in some of the results at the end of this talk, general hyperparameter optimization methods do apply and kind of surprisingly work quite well. That said, it is an exciting area where, intuitively at least, it seems possible if you're working on a specialized subproblem of a broader problem that you should be able to do better. So, all right, so let's work through a toy example of kind of what you're trying to do in hyperparameter optimization, how we define success, and also kind of what people have done before. So we're going to start with our toy example with the classical MNIST data set. You have a bunch of images. You want to label them. You want to predict whether they're between 0 and 9. Imagine you want to train this model on a very simple neural network, and you have some model space or space of hyperparameters that you want to be fiddling with. Right, so in this toy example, you might care about, you might be trying different activation functions or different numbers of hidden units per layer. So that is actually related to the architecture itself, the number of hidden layers, and maybe the regularizer that you're using. Right, so now given this search space, given this problem that you want to solve, what do you end up doing? Well, it's a pretty simple thing that you do. From that search space, you pick a particular set of hyperparameters, and then you use some black box solver to train the model with the data for those hyperparameters. And then you evaluate it on some validation or held out set, you get some predictive error or score for the quality of these hyperparameters. Right? And then kind of traditional hyperparameter optimization says just, don't do this once or twice, but just keep doing it over and over again until you run out of time, run out of money, or hopefully kind of more optimistically, you find a result that you're happy with. Right? So we're trying to minimize error here. So in this case, for these for this set of hyperparameter configurations we looked at, this guy in blue is the best. And kind of more generally, the question that hyperparameter optimization is asking is how can we efficiently identify these high-quality hyperparameters, right? And by efficiently, that's in terms of resources consumed. That can be time or money. And in terms of quality, there's some notion of predictive error, right? And there's different ways to measure error, but that's roughly the point. Any questions? Everyone on the same page? Cool. All right, so this is not a new problem. This is something that, ever since people have been doing machine learning, all algorithms have knobs that need to be tuned. People have been doing this for a while. What are kind of canonical ways to do this? Well, kind of the most canonical way to do it is, you know, random or grid search. Random search, for reasons we can talk about offline, is slightly a better thing to do. But this is kind of the simplest thing that you can do. This is a toy example. Imagine you have two hyperparameters. The red parts of this picture are kind of hotspots, the good areas in the hyperparameter space. Random search says something very simple, which is just randomly pick points in this hyperparameter space, evaluate the models associated with each of these hyperparameters or each of these hyperparameter configurations, and if you sample enough of them, you hope that one of them is going to be close to one of these hotspots, and then you're happy, right? Kind of an alternative approach to doing this, and this is something that was popularized, you know, at this point 5 to 7 years ago. These are adaptive selection methods or Bayesian optimization methods. The idea for these methods is you first do some coarse random exploration of a space, but once you've done that, instead of continually randomly sampling hyperparameter configurations, you try to learn from what you've seen before, and hopefully you can, you know, see patterns in terms of what areas might be more or less promising, and so you adaptively select your subsequent configurations based on what you've seen. And so sort of in this example, things seem to be working well. The subsequent configurations that you pick are going to be concentrated around the red hotspots, which is kind of what you want. So, you know, are these good or bad methods? The answer is kind of, it depends. And to explain what I mean by that, imagine we have we're working with a problem that has d hyperparameters. In these toy examples, d equals 2, but, you know, d can be whatever it is. And imagine you have a budget to evaluate n hyperparameter configurations. So here n is like 15 or 16, however many of those black spots you see, right? So then to kind of understand if these methods are good or not, we can imagine kind of two different settings that are common. So one setting, or the first case, is a setting where n is much larger than d. Meaning, you know, imagine you have two or three hyperparameters and training each model is not that expensive, so you can train hundreds or thousands of them. So roughly I'm saying, you know, n is 1,000, d is 3. I'm being vague here about what exponential, but n is a lot bigger than d, right? If you're in that setting, then, you know, random exploration will, with high probability, allow you to actually explore, you know, enough of the space to hopefully find a good part of the space, and you're in good shape. So I'm saying you can kind of cover the space. If you can cover the space, then it makes a lot of sense to then be adaptive once you've covered it to try to fine-tune and find, you know, better neighbors from, you know, a good starting point. And so adaptivity works well as well. But there's this other setting where the number of configurations you're considering is roughly linear in the number of hyperparameters you have. So let's say, you know, instead of having two or three hyperparameters, you have 15 or 20 hyperparameters. And let's say training each model is really expensive, so you want to train, you know, 10 or 100 models, right? So then the two things are kind of, you know, on par with each other. And in that case, you can't really cover the space. The space is really big due to the curse of dimensionality. The volume of these hyperparameter spaces is going to grow exponentially with a dimension, with the number of hyperparameters you have. And so you need exponentially more hyperparameter, or exponentially more configurations to look at to kind of explore the space in a reasonable way. So you can't really do that in this setting. If you can't even explore the space, there's no way to learn from what you've seen, and being adaptive kind of doesn't make sense, right? And kind of the bad news is that this is the regime that we're typically in the context of deep learning. Training models is really expensive. It can take days to weeks, right? There's a lot of hyperparameters to configure. 10 or 20 is not uncommon. And so what do we do? So the idea, the kind of broad intuition we had, is that we kind of just need to change the game. We need to do something different. We have to solve a different problem because this problem is too hard in the context of deep learning. And so our idea is to somehow use downsampling to effectively evaluate more configurations on the same budget. Right? We have resource limitations, but we need to see more configurations, so we somehow downsample in order to do that. So that's kind of the rough idea. And that sort of is a good segue into this first work that I'll be talking about, which is called Hyperband. And this is our idea about principled early stopping. It's work with several collaborators, in particular my student Liam Lee at CMU. Right, so what are we downsampling? That's kind of the next question, right? It seems like it could be a good idea, but how do we get this to work? Well, so our observation is, especially in the context of things like deep learning, but also other, you know, lots of methods are iterative. They require, you know, you train via SGD. But basically, taking advantage of the fact that algorithms are iterative, we can sample the number of iterations used to train each model. So how does that work? So imagine this toy example. Imagine the x-axis here is the number of iterations. The y-axis is predictive error. And now each of these traces corresponds to a different model. Right? So this is a setting where we're training all the models. We're allocating the same number of iterations to all these models each of these, each of these models corresponds to, say, a different hyperparameter configuration. But the argument that we're making is that for this hyperparameter hyperparameter optimization problem, our goal is to find the best hyperparameter configuration. So we actually don't really care about, once we know that some of these traces or some of these models are not going to be competitors, that they're not really that good, we actually don't really care what they converge to. We just need to know that they're not good, that we can discard them. What we really care about is differentiating between the subset of the configurations that are actually really promising. And we want as quickly as possible to find out from the subset that could potentially be promising which ones are actually the best or which one is the best, right? And so that's intuitively the idea. The problem, of course, though, is that it's a lot easier said than done, right? So the previous figure that I showed, everything was kind of nice and well behaved. But what happens if a sequence of configurations was something like this, right? Then how do you know how to early stop, when to early stop? Right. So how can we sort of safely discard a configuration? And so I'll go into a few more details about this method. But in a nutshell, the main result and the thing that's cool about hyperband is that, right, it's this novel downsampling approach. It's kind of executing on this intuition that we've been talking about. But it demonstrates state-of-the-art empirical performance, as I'll show, but it also kind of is provably correct. It deals with a safety issue, right? So we show how you can, without making any real strong assumptions, you can avoid kind of being overly aggressive or overly conservative in how much you're downsampling. So I'll go into a little bit more details there, but that's kind of the high-level point. Questions? Yes?
So AutoML is very computationally expensive, right? It relies on large GPUs, otherwise you don't get...
So AutoML is very computationally expensive,
when
right?
When you say AutoML, what does that mean? What are you talking about? You're talking about Google's neural architecture search?
Yeah. Because you're saying hyperparameter tuning, it's majorly applied on AutoML, right, these days?
AutoML is this broad umbrella of automating any part of ML. Yeah. Hyperparameter optimization is tuning knobs of...
It's not specific to AutoML, right?
AutoML is a broader term than, at least the way I've defined it.
Okay.
So,
yeah, then it's pretty clear, yeah. My question is majorly regarding AutoML, for example. I think Google takes about, the last paper that I read was, it took about 7 days for learning AmoebaNet. And it used a lot of hyperparameter tuning as well. So what my question is, it's a lot computationally expensive to do so, most of it. So how does it apply to any small organizations or something like that to implement such stuff?
Right. So I don't know the particular work that you're talking about. The point is that we want to speed these things up, right? The 5 years ago, if you wanted to do hyperparameter optimization on deep learning models, it would take days to weeks. These methods, they're general purpose methods, but they are, 1 to 2 orders of magnitude faster. That's kind of the, as you'll see, they're 5 to 60 times, whatever the number there, but they're kind of drastically faster. There's new methods which are not, we have a paper coming out about this later, so I can talk to you offline about it, but these are these architecture search methods which do different things. They don't quite work as well as they should yet, but they have the hope of being even faster. A big point is there's accuracy, but there's accuracy, there's how fast it is, and then there's kind of how robust they are. And all of those things kind of matter if you practically want to be doing these things. Yeah. Okay, so how does this hyperband method work? So there's two ingredients. The first one is called successive halving. As you'll see, the example that I'm talking about, and in practice, thirding seems to work better, so that's why I have having in quotes. So I'm going to call it SHA. How does it work? So let's go through an example. So again, same figure here. You have iterations on the x-axis, predictive error on the y-axis. We're going to start with this example. We have 9 configurations that we're considering. For each of these configurations, we're going to allocate 9 iterations of work. Basically, we're going to do 9 updates of the weight vectors, right? And then we're going to evaluate them. So if you count, there's 9 triangles here, and at the they're all lined up at x equals 9. And basically, after allocating that many resources to each of these 9 configurations, we're going to do this thirding. We're going to say we're going to keep the best 3 of these 9, the best 1/3, and basically the 3 with the lowest predictive error. Right, so we make that, we decide to throw everything out above that line out and keep everything below. And then we allocate more resources to those top configurations. So now we train them for a total of 27 iterations, and we have these top three. We do a thirding again, and we, you know, train the best one longer, right? So that's roughly kind of the idea. And kind of the assumptions baked into this is that any model is trained for a max number of iterations. That's typically what you do anyway when you're training any individual model. You say, I'm going to train it for 5 epochs or 10 epochs or whatever. So this R here is just the max number of epochs you want to train for. You have some total budget, which is, you know, if you're doing random search or something where you're not doing early stopping, if it's 5R, that means you're just considering 5 configurations. But here we're decoupling the total budget from the total number of configurations that we're looking at. N here is 9, which means that on average, we're allocating, you know, less than, you know, less, we're averaging, allocating 5/9 to each of these, guys, right? Sorry, 9/5, 5/9, whatever, you can figure it out. Right, so the next question, though, right, you might be thinking, we talked about safety here, right? Like, the idea of if we stop, do you stop too early, do you stop too late? And this success of having an algorithm on its own is not really solving that problem, right? So imagine you have this red triangle here, right? This is one of the other configurations. Imagine if it's a late bloomer. Imagine if you had trained it to completion, if it would have done really well, it just would take more time to kind of, you know, demonstrate its worth, right? And so there's this kind of innate issue that if as you increase N, as you downsample more, you increase the effective number of configurations you're looking at, but you may introduce more errors, right? You might falsely stop something too soon. And moreover, you don't really know a priori what the right thing to do is because it depends on unknown convergence properties, you know, how these models actually converge as a function of the more iterations that you train on. It's hard to model that. You don't really know a priori how this is going to work. Right? So that kind of brings us to the second ingredient, which we call safe downsampling. And kind of in a nutshell, I have an animated slide, but I think it's easy just to kind of walk through it really quickly. The point is that there are different ways to run successive halving with different levels of aggression. So the column in the middle with S equals 2, that corresponds to starting with 9 configurations and then going, you know, in what we're calling the first rung. In the second rung, you go to 3 configurations and you go down to 1. On all the way on the extreme would be random search, where you start with 5 configurations and you train them all 81 iterations, which is what we're calling the max number of iterations that, you know, you can train any model. On the other extreme, you can downsample, you can start with 81 iterations, allocate a single iteration, 81, sorry, configurations, allocate a single iteration to each of them, and go through 5 different rungs until you get to one that's trained to completion, right? So there's, as you go further left, you're being more aggressive. As you go further right, you're being more conservative. And basically, this is kind of an example, a toy example on MNIST using this LANET model, so simple model, simple data, but it kind of demonstrates how these different methods are working. And what you see is that random search in red is way too conservative, right? The predictive error goes down really slowly as a function of time. But the most aggressive one, S equals 4, is yellow, is too aggressive. It doesn't quite do as well. It turns out that S equals 3, which is the second most aggressive instantiation of successive halving, does the best here. How do you know that? You don't. There's no way to know a priori how aggressive or how conservative to be. And so Hyperban, which is the algorithm that we're proposing, which is in blue here, basically says just try them all, right? There's not that many different things to try. There's 5 things to try. You can probably just scrap random search because it's way too conservative. But you can try a small, basically a constant number of different ways to be more or less aggressive and do really well. And that's a statement both empirical, it's both an empirical and a theoretical statement. So let's see how it looks or how it works in practice. So this is an example of tuning a neural network. This is a 4-layer CNN. We're working with Safari 10 with 8 hyperparameters. And right, there's 3 competitors here. One is random search. The other, we're calling it just an arbitrary adaptive method. For these experiments, we tried, I think, 3 or 4 different Bayesian optimization methods. For different experiments, different Bayesian optimization methods were better or worse. For this particular experiment, I think a method called SMAC was the best. And then we see how Hyperban looks, and right, it's doing significantly better, but there's a few kind of key points to emphasize here. So one, right, on the x-axis here is kind of the budget, the amount of resources we're spending as a function, you know, performance as a function of number of iterations. And at 5R here, Both random and adaptive have evaluated exactly 5 models. They've trained them to completion and then evaluated them. In contrast, hyperband by downsampling has looked at 256. And that's kind of the magic, right? Looking at so many more, it's able to explore the space a lot better. It's getting noisy estimates of the quality of all of these different models, but that seems to be enough to kind of make reasonable decisions. So we see over 50x speedup compared to random search, a 10x speedup over these adaptive methods. And another really cool thing is, right, we typically see that we get lower final error, not just on this model, but across, or on this particular problem, but across a lot of problems. But we always see lower variance. And this isn't surprising, right? The idea is that these are actually experiment. This isn't a single run of these methods. This is averaging over 10 trials, so 10 different, you know, train test splits. And the point is, someone who's a practitioner isn't going to do that. They're going to just run something once and see how it works. And you kind of want a good result every single time. You don't want something that 1 in 10 does really well the rest of the time, you're unlucky. And Hyperband, again, because it's looking at so many more configurations, is much less varying across different runs. Right, so we focused really on the iterative setting, but this works in non-iterative settings as well, right? So if your algorithm is an iterative, you can downsample other things, right? You can downsample either data or features, right? So you can start training with, you know, 1/10 of your data, then 1/5 of your data, and so on. Or, you know, in the case of if you're working with random features for kernel-like methods, you can, you know, work with more and more random features, and again, kind of do the search and adaptively that way. Yeah.
Have you actually run some experiments with this, downsampling data and using non-iterative algorithms? The only reason I ask is, intuitively, it feels like many algorithms, the hyperparameters depend on the size of the data. And so as soon as you modify the size of the data, you're modifying, you know, you need to modify a number of other hyperparameters.
Yes. So it is definitely true that depending on how, some, like a regularizer is going to depend, the more data you have, the less you're going to want to regularize. So that is true. We haven't run it as extensively in those settings, but we have, right, so this is kind of showing a schematic of trying with more and more data. This is one example with data downsampling. This is a kernel-based classification. The results are actually much better here, partly because the models that we're training are super linear in their runtime. So, right, if you downsample by 10, you don't get a 10x speedup, you get a 100x speedup. And so the speedups are much, much better. But I agree, there could potentially be more work to be done here. The vast majority of the experiments that we've run have been in the iterative setting, just because the most pressing hyperparameter optimization problems are for deep learning, and they're iterative. It's the easiest way to kind of do it. And actually, another important point here is that if you're downsampling iterations, you know, if you first train with for 10 iterations, or for one iteration, then for 10, then for 20, whatever, you can reuse the work, right? You can just, whereas if you downsample data points, you can't actually reuse it. So there's kind of more overhead associated with doing that. Yeah. Right. Next question. Next question is kind of what can we say theoretically? I'm going to pretty much skip this part. Very happy to talk about it afterwards. All I will say is that you can frame this problem as a multi-arm bandit problem. So the multi-arm bandit problem is sort of, it comes from, you think about casinos, you have a bunch of slot machines. The idea is that you want to pull all the arms of the different slot machines to find out which one pretty much is the least bad, which one is ripping you off the least. And there's this kind of trade-off between, right, there's a bunch of different problems that you can formulate for this multi-arm bandit problem, but there's a best arm identification problem, which is, How quickly, with how many arm pulls of these different slot machines, what is the minimum number of arm pulls I need in order to find the best slot machine? And that's a very natural, you can frame this problem exactly the same way. Each arm is a different hyperparameter configuration. Pulling an arm corresponds to training, you know, allocating another resource, another iteration to that model. And the question is, you know, how many arm pulls total do I need before I identify the best one? And there's other extensions that we've looked at, but I'll leave that for offline. But the point is that the cool thing is that we're able to show that hyperband, by hedging a little bit, trying different levels of aggression, can provably do within a constant factor of kind of the best thing that you could do if you knew the right amount of aggression to downsample with in the first place. So compared to an oracle, compared to the best you could possibly do, hyperband is only a constant factor worse, which is a nice guarantee to have. Okay, so the next and last question that I'm going to be talking about, which is related to the title of the talk, is what do you do if you're really impatient? And I mean by that is, you know, if it takes a really long time to train models and you want answers quickly, what can you do? Kind of a natural thing to do is to leverage distributed hardware and parallelize the search. And the last part of the talk, what I'll kind of talk you through is how to actually do that. It sort of, on first glance, it might seem like an obvious, a trivial thing to parallelize. It turns out that it's actually not. It requires a little bit of thought and a little bit of care. But if you think about it the right way, it generalizes pretty well to parallel and distributed implementations. So that's this last part of the work, massively parallel optimization. It's a method we call ASHA. The A here stands for asynchronous, and then the SHA is the successive halving algorithm that we talked about earlier. List of collaborators, again, led by my student Liam. So, right, we're going back to this set of quotes that we talked about at the beginning of the talk. And, you know, if you think about the numbers, like even if it only takes a day to train each of these models, forget about a week. If it takes a day to train each of these models, that means you're training 10,000 models. And given the amount of total amount of time required to train to do this work, that means, you know, 29 years of compute to actually do what you want. You know, you want an answer in a day or a week, certainly not a year, certainly not 29 years. So this is, I mean, you kind of need to be parallel if you're going to do something like this, right? That's pretty obvious. So this is what I call the large-scale regime of hyperparameter optimization, and there's a few kind of subtle points about it, which is that the goal here is to evaluate a number of models that is significantly more than the number of workers you have. And what do I mean by that? Even if you're at Google, and a lot of the experiments here we ran at Google with collaborators there, even if you're at Google, sure, they might have 10,000 or 50,000, I don't know how many GPUs they have, but you as an individual person working there, even if you're Jeff Dean, you're not training on all 10,000 GPUs at the same time, right? You're sharing these resources, hopefully you're sharing all these resources with your team. And if you want to train 10,000 models, even if you're working in parallel, maybe you have access to 100 GPUs, right? So you have way more models to train than workers to actually train in parallel on. Second, there's a question of your budget here. And before we talked, you can think about budget in terms of cost, but here our budget is in terms of time. Even if you have, you know, even if you have these 100 machines, it's the time until you get a result. If it takes a day to train a model, maybe you're okay waiting 2 days for this result to come back, but you're not really okay waiting a month. That's too long for you to iterate and sort of, you know, kind of training deep learning models, training all of machine learning is this iterative process. You need feedback as quickly as possible, right? So kind of the key is that you might have these K workers, these 100 workers, training a model to completion on any one of them takes a day. You want an answer in 2 days, right? Rather than in 2 weeks or 2 months or 29 years. Right, so kind of the naive methods that we've talked, or the classical methods we've talked about before, random search doesn't work. You don't have enough workers to train your 100, you know, use your 100 workers on 10,000 models, that'll take too long. You know, picking points adaptively, these adaptive search methods really don't work because you're still training to completion. And more importantly, if you're training things in parallel, the whole point about being adaptive is that you're kind of learning from what you've seen before. But if you're training a bunch of things in parallel, you're making a bunch of decisions at the same time without the benefit of the previous information that you've had. So it kind of really hinders, being parallel hinders the idea of being adaptive. And you have less information to work with. And so the obvious next question is, what about parallelizing hyperband or successive halving? And so that's what I'll talk about next. I'm going to be focusing on successive halving. It's really the inner loop for hyperband. So the results apply to both, but we're going to be focusing on how to get successive halving to work in parallel. And to understand why it's not trivially obvious, let's remember how this method works, right? Remember we said that we start with, say, 9 configurations. We then go down to 3, then we go to 1. I'm going to introduce new terminology here. I kind of mentioned it before, this idea of rungs. So the idea is that we start with everything starts in the bottommost rung. We promote the best subset to the next rung. We promote the next, you know, once we're in that next rung, we promote the next subset to the following rung. So with that idea in mind, you can imagine, right, how is a computation distributed in a, how is a computation allocated if you have, or what is the order in which you're executing these jobs, whether it's on a single machine or not? And basically what you're seeing here is that we have 9 configurations, all of which are at the bottom rung. We have to execute all of them until before we can decide which of the top 3. and then we execute all the ones on the next rung, decide which one's the best, promote it to the final rung, and then execute that completely, right? So this is kind of what it would look like if we were doing this in parallel. Actually, before I show it to you, maybe I should explain what's going on. The x-axis here, on the left plot, the x-axis is the number of configurations we're evaluating. The y-axis is, for each of these configurations, what rung gets on. This right figure, now we're imagining we're doing this on 10 workers. And so the real question is, how do you distribute successive halving in parallel on 10 workers, right? And so there's 10 workers, and if you see nothing blue, that means they're not working at all. Otherwise, it tells you what rung of a job it's running. Is it training something in rung one, rung two, rung three, whatever? And it's a pretty obvious thing that I'm saying here, but as you get further along in the process, most of your workers are idle. They're not doing anything because there's a smaller and smaller number of active workers that are actually, you know, a smaller and smaller of configurations that are still active. So there's not that much to do. So the resource efficiency is pretty bad. This issue is compounded when dealing with stragglers and preemption, right? So if you're working in a parallel distributed setting, some of your machines are going to be faster than others. Some of the hyperparameters you're going to be considering also impact the runtime, so not all of your configurations are going to finish at the same time. If you're in a system where you're sharing, if you're in a setting where you're sharing resources with other people, right, you might get preempted. There might be a higher priority job that preempts you, so you need to pause your work. That's further going to block this method because it's synchronous, right? So, in summary, hyperban and successive halving, they suffer from stragglers and low utilization. And so the kind of key intuition, which I've already given away, is that we want to run a variant of successive halving asynchronously. And so let me tell you why that is a nice thing to do. Right, this again is a picture of how you evaluate things in successive halving. Right, and the key point here is that we need to see everything in the bottom rung to decide. We want to know exactly what the optimal three to promote are. And to do that, we need to see everything in the bottom rung first. And then similarly, we need to see all three in the middle, in the second rung to promote the optimal one in the top rung. The idea in the asynchronous setting is, right, so, you know, you can think about the synchronous setting as saying we're promoting the top one third. But to get the exact top one third, you need to see everything that you're looking at. You can alternatively, and what we do in the asynchronous setting is saying we're at any point, we're going to optimistically, whenever we can, promote whatever is currently in the top one third. So instead of having to look at all nine of them before we can promote three, we look at three of them and promote the top one. It may or may not actually be among the top, you know, top third among all nine of them. But one thing you can convince yourself of pretty simply is that we might be promoting things that wouldn't have gotten promoted in retrospect, but we're not going to not promote anything that should have been promoted because we're always promoting whatever is in the top one third. And if something at the end should be in the top one third, it'll eventually be found and promoted, right? And so the idea is that, right, so the key point here is that we're being asynchronous on the right. We're also not running exactly the same algorithm. The results aren't guaranteed to be the same. But if anything, we're going to just erroneously promote a few additional configurations in the asynchronous setting relative to the synchronous setting. And kind of the other point is that as you see more and more configurations, you expect fewer and fewer erroneous promotions, right? So this problem, right, when you look at the first three and you promote one, maybe all three of the first three that you looked at were all really bad and you shouldn't have promoted any of them. But after six, that's less likely. After nine, less likely. And if you have more and more things in the bottom rung, it gets less and less likely just by, you know, the law of large numbers, by very simple arguments. Right, so we can look at the same picture now for the asynchronous setting in terms of how resources are being allocated. And basically, the punchline is that we get, you know, 100% efficiency pretty much the entire time. We promote, and when we can't promote something, we can start new things on the bottom rung. And so we can always get, we can always maintain, you know, 100% resource efficiency. Right, so it's nearly 100% efficiency. And again, the other kind of point that you get as a side benefit is that models are trained to completion more quickly. So you get the end result for some subset of models a lot faster than you otherwise would in the synchronous setting. All right, so how does this work? I'll show a few results here. The first one is again on SAFAR 10 on a CNN. 10 hyperparameters, 25 workers in parallel. There's four competitors. One is ASHA, one is SHA, one is PBT, which is an evolutionary-based method. which is kind of by definition asynchronous itself. The fourth competitor is this thing called Bob, which is combining, it really stands for Bayesian optimization plus hyperband. It's trying to combine the two things together. What we find, there's a lot of things going on here, but basically we see that ASHA and PBT both drastically outperform SHA and Bob, and ASHA slightly outperforms PBT. Next experiment we run, this is a much larger scale experiment. This is run internally at Google, 500 workers now, so pretty massively parallel. 9 hyperparameters, this is on the pen tree bank task, which is a very common benchmarking task, training an LSTM. We compare ASHA with asynchronous hyperband, and basically it's just different loops of ASHA with Vizier, which is Google's in-house hyperparameter tuning service. And sort of what we see is that, you know, both ASHA and hyperband drastically outperform Vizier here. And kind of surprisingly, hyperband is not much worse than ASHA, which is kind of neat. An important point to note here is that the actual, you know, the raw perplexity numbers here, right? Lower perplexity is better. These numbers are not very good, right? So there's always this challenge in hyperparameter optimization that, you know, are you trying, we're not necessarily trying to get state-of-the-art accuracy. We want to say that on, you know, a fixed benchmarking problem, how well do we do relative to other competitors? And, you know, in this case, we can say, hey, we're doing a lot better. That said, of course, you also do want to get state-of-the-art results. You want to say that your method can really be the best on a particular benchmark. So we tried to do that next. So this is, again, the same data set, but a different search space, a different model. Now 16 workers, and we're comparing just PBT and ASHA. The goal here is, again, to compare these two head-to-head, but also to see if we can get better results. And what we see is that, right, weirdly, PBT starts a little bit better, but ASHA does significantly better over time relative to PBT. These perplexity results are better, but typically what you do is, you know, you do hyperparameter optimization to find a configuration that's good. Once you have that final configuration, you might train it significantly longer to kind of improve accuracy even more. So that's what we do. We take the best, you know, the best architecture at the end of this 1,400 minutes, we train it significantly longer, and we compare it against kind of known results for this data set. And right, these are known results, and this is kind of bringing us back comparing standard hyperparameter optimization to architecture search. Of these top methods, some of them are, right, they're using different search spaces, different models, but some of them are, you know, the second, the NAS-ZOF and NAS-ZOF there, those are two variants of neural architecture search. Some of these other ones are just using different architectures and tuning via standard hyperparameter optimization. Point is that ASHA tuned on this particular hyperparameter search space, we get what was at the time state-of-the-art results. Again, the goal really isn't to get state-of-the-art results. This was as of like the middle of last year. If you look at iClear, which is another leading deep learning conference, there's this paper called DARTS, there's proxyless NAS, there's other papers that have since beaten these numbers, and that's not really the point. The main point is just to say that, you know, a general purpose distributed hyperparameter optimization method that is principled and very simple can do really, really well on sort of leading benchmarks. All right, so I'm pretty much done. I'm just going to spend the last few minutes kind of wrapping up. I want to give a 2-minute pitch about what we're doing at our startup and kind of how it ties back to this idea of getting to the jet age of machine learning. Right, so we talked about we want to get to the jet age of machine learning. I think that what we've been talking about so far in this talk today about training and tuning models is a step in that direction. How do we train models faster? How do we train a bunch of models faster to do the hyperparameter optimization more quickly and maybe in a more automated and kind of reliable fashion? But kind of the key point is that, you know, training one model or doing hyperparameter optimization during the training step is one component of a larger workflow. Right, there's lots of moving pieces when you want to develop these models, starting from collecting data through deployment and under the hood doing a lot of hard things in terms of keeping track of your data, keeping track of your hardware, sharing and collaborating with other people. And existing software right now is kind of really focused on a subset. Things like TensorFlow or Keras are great at what they do, but they're largely focused on this model training component. And this is not a great state for a deep learning engineer to be in. Right, deep learning engineers are unicorns right now. It's hard to find really good people who know how to do this stuff. They're really impeded by the lack of good software and good infrastructure. Right? It leads to really long iteration cycles and ad hoc solutions. Right, you can ship traditional software, new releases on the order of weeks or months. You can ship a new deep learning product on the order of years. And once it's shipped, it stays shipped because you have no idea how you got it, you can't reproduce it, and it's kind of just scary to change it. And that's not the way things can be moving forward, as machine learning and deep learning are powering really important applications in society. Right? So kind of the fundamental idea is that software development just needs to be reinvented for this AI age, when everything is uncertain and data-driven and so data-hungry. And so what we're working on at Determined AI, we have an end-to-end platform that gives deep learning teams the tools they need to streamline their workflows. Right? We have, as we've talked about today, best-in-class AutoML capabilities. We focus a lot on automated GPU resource optimization. Right? If you're at Google, you have the ability to be preempted because everybody is sharing their resources in an automated way. If you're pretty much anywhere else, well, if you're at Amazon, probably also. If you're almost anywhere else, you don't have this. You're on a shared spreadsheet, and you're using, you know, Bob's using the GPUs Mondays and Wednesday. Alice is on Tuesdays and Thursday. That's not great. Our system seamlessly records your metadata for reproducibility and collaboration. We support cloud, on-prem, or hybrid usage. That hybrid usage is becoming more and more common these days. And we're not trying to reinvent the wheel. Things, again, like TensorFlow, PyTorch, Keras are great at what they do. The idea is that you can kind of pretty much drag and drop what you're already doing into our system and get and kind of unlock the benefits pretty quickly and easily. All right, so with that, I'll wrap up. There's links to my papers, links to some blog posts that I've written on this topic of the jet age of ML and on the idea of architecture search and hyperparameter tuning. I'll give a quick plug for SysML. It's a conference I helped start and then I'm the general chair of this year, which is really focusing on problems at the intersection of systems and machine learning, which is kind of squarely where my research is and where determined AI, I think, is excelling. And with that, I'll thank you. Come talk to us. John and Yoav are in the back. They have some t-shirts. We're all happy to talk to you more if you have any questions. So thank you.
Maybe one or two questions. Is that okay?
Yeah, of course.
Before we turn off the mic, here we go.
A very nice talk. I have a good question. So you mentioned about the low variance of hyperband, is that right? So why is the variance of hyperband lower than the adaptive method, and how does it scale in like high dimensional spaces?
So I didn't understand the last part. Why is what?
Why is the variance lower compared to the Bayesian optimization?
Yeah. So our intuition, it's simply that by looking at more, if you look at more configurations, but basically variance tends to go down as your sample size goes up. And so by looking at more configurations, by downsampling, we're looking at way more configurations relative to these other methods. And so it's not surprising that we're getting kind of similar results across different trials. Yeah.
So quick question. When you were going through your it looked like you had kind of a genetic algorithm-ish method where you just took off a certain part, like in a regular genetic algorithm, you would go in and lop off half the population and then...
Yeah. So that's exactly what PBT does.
Right, okay.
PBT is a genetic algorithm. And it works well. It is naturally asynchronous. It's the right thing to compare against. And surprisingly, we beat it. Granted, it's on the task that we're looking at.
You don't know why?
I mean, I would say the argument should go the other way. I know exactly what we are doing. I can provably tell you how it's performing, when it's performing, and why it's doing what it's doing. I don't know why PBT is doing anything it's doing, and we still beat it. So yeah, I would argue that the simple method that is provable is the right baseline. If you can't beat it, you should explain. Not you, but the developer of the method should explain why, not the other way around. Yeah.
More questions? Yes.
Yeah.
Just this image, there are some notable drops there.
Yeah.
Is that due to like learning rate drops, or is it due to...
Right, so that's an interesting thing. There are a lot, like, so these are experiments that Liam ran. Getting PBT to run in this setting required some tweaking of it. He was very favorable to PBT to get it to work. It has its own hyperparameters that you have to tune. He tried various ones, tuned it to get it to work well. Why exactly? It definitely starts better and then plateaus.
No, I'm talking about the notable drops in ASHA there. Like in the middle, there's a deep... There are some, you know, just notable periods where it really... I was just wondering, is that like learning rate?
My guess...
Case, or is that final rung?
I think it's because it's in parallel. I'm almost positive for both of them, it's because it's in parallel. And the way they're run is that, like, you know, if you first are training for 10 minutes before, and like the first, they, it's starting around 10 minutes, you all of a sudden get a lot of new information because all the workers in parallel, they're asynchronous, there's some stragglers, but from minute 9 to 15, you're getting all the new information,
right.
And then from minute 15 to 1 hour, you're getting nothing.
So potentially the high rung ones all finish.
Right,
now.
Exactly. Everything finishes, and then exactly.
And maybe one more question.
Hi, so you mentioned previously that whatever the one-third of
yep.
the diagram, it's being promoted. And
yep.
so what are the characteristics of factors that determine that?
It's really just, so at the beginning I was showing you how the way you score a model, it's basically you take a model, whether it's fully trained or partially trained, you evaluate the quality of that model on some held out set. So you have the predictive error on the validation set, and that's the score you give to all the models, and you just sort them by which ones are better or worse.
Oh, okay. All
yeah.
right, cool.
Right, so actually it says right there, right? So the y-axis there is just predictive error on the validation set. So all of those models, even though they're not fully trained, you can still evaluate how none of the accuracies are going to be great because you haven't trained them that long, but they'll still give you some accuracy, hopefully better than random. And indeed, they vary a bunch. And so the idea is that the ones that aren't promising according to the metric you finally care about, which is predictive error, at the beginning, you just throw them out and you just focus on the ones that are good.
Thank you.
Well, once again, I want to thank you very much for an excellent presentation.
Thank you.